Good morning and welcome to National Avenue Christian Church. We are gathering here for worship. We'll be gathering with our coffee, with our communion, with our candles. We're here in, as we gather, join us.
Good morning and welcome to National Avenue Christian Church Disciples of Christ in Springfield, Missouri, in our new online version of services during the COVID-19 worldwide pandemic. We are happy that you are here with us this morning, and we are excited to let you know a few things about our church and a few things that you might want to do to prepare for our service this morning. And we do have a few more minutes still yet before that service will start. My name is Ashley Quinn. My pronouns are he, him, his, and I'm the Justice Coordinator here at National Avenue Christian Church. We are an open and affirming congregation, and we are glad that you are here. We have some ways that we communicate. One, we have a weekly emailed newsletter called The Avenues, and that you can sign up for that on our Facebook page by clicking sign up. Or you can also email us hello@nationalavenuecc.com. That's National Avenue spelled out, cc.com. And we will get you signed up for that. We also have some text alerts. If you email us, we can get you the info for how to sign up for our text alerts. For this service this morning, there is a PDF that has been shared will give you the liturgy to be able to follow along, the words that we're going to say together, the songs that we're going to sing together. So do look for that link as well. And then we invite you to bring a couple of things to your space this morning, so that we can really, really experience this together. One of those is a candle. We'll have a moment during the service where we'll all light a candle together. So we invite you to bring a candle and something to light it with, or an electronic candle. We also will have communion today. The communion table is really central to our identity within the Disciples of Christ. It's central to the way that we understand that we do things. All are welcome at this table. And any kind of food or drink item that you might have laying around your house is welcome at this table as well. So communion, I think, for me this morning is gonna be Coke and donuts. It could be Ritz crackers. It could be a squeezable yogurt or applesauce, juice, coffee, tea, water, whatever you got laying around, literally, can be the bread and the cup this morning. It can be made sacred in our sharing it in this time together. So we invite you to get those pieces together. We will also, just to let you know, we'll have an opportunity to pass the peace. Since we are not shaking hands or hugging right now, those heart reacts on Facebook, sending a wave, letting us know that you're there in the comment section, it really puts smiles on all of our faces to see and interact with each other there. So we invite you to do that. And we'll also have an opportunity to share prayers. Now keep in mind, if you put a prayer request in the Facebook comments, that's going to be public. We're going to have somebody reading those out loud during the
Zoom worship is always full of delightful surprises. So we appreciate your patience as we wait and see about the intro video coming back together. I've seen so many faces. It's so good to know that you're out there and we're joining together.
That community meeting, then we would break out into those from that Zoom link. So watch for that Zoom link in the comments when we get to that part and get towards the end of the service, and you can join us there. So at this time, we just invite you, if you haven't gotten those things together, to go ahead and get your communion elements and get your candle and your lighter together. We do still have a few more minutes before the service will start. And then just collect yourself, center yourself, take some moments to breathe. We'll have some piano music here played by Jonathan Rainey, our music director, that will take us into a walk through the gardens that are not our gardens, but they just happen to be next to our church. So we included those in this video. And then also a walk through of the inside of our building for those who may be missing that or have never seen the inside of our building before. So we'll have a little bit of a walkthrough. The chimes will play from our church, and then the service will start. So you do have about 5 or 10 more minutes still to get together your things And again, we're really excited that you're here. We're really happy to join and share in this experience with you this morning. It is a little different than what we might be used to as church, but we will be doing this throughout the month of May, and maybe longer. And we are so glad to have this opportunity to share in this way with you.
We gather as those seeking hope, hope for new conversations as we talk about mental health, hope for stigmas to fall, hope for religious communities to change the conversation, hope to be the ones to speak the truth and make room for truths to be shared and affirmed.
Creating spirit, we seek to be ones to create space for love to be made known. We seek the wisdom that exists in each one of us. May we listen, stay curious, offer our stories, and give our wisdom to one another. As we continue to navigate through the unknown territories of the COVID pandemic and everything associated with it, we recognize the toll all of this has had on everyone's mental health. As we continue to focus on ways to stay connected and offer support, we are aware of our need to have spaces for people to connect, share their struggles, talk about things, and find overall support in one another.
Even before the outbreak, there are people who live with mental health struggles daily. Unnamed diagnoses that were once taboo to mention are now becoming just as common to talk about as the weather. Stigmas around mental health are being broken, so we can comfortably share our struggles, stories, and experiences with others more freely and widely and wholly. To each of you who with particular mental health diagnoses,
we see you.
To each of you who have and are figuring out ways to maneuver around and manage all of the stress related to COVID pandemic, we see you.
There are also many around us without the support they need, maybe even unaware that they struggle with depression, anxiety, or bipolar. Because of the stigma associated with mental health issues, there are people suffering in silence. No matter where you are at with your mental health, we see you.
We hear you.
And you are not alone. We light this candle, the light of Christ, to remind us of the light, Christ, in all things.
Good job, Stephanie.
Good morning. Thank you for inviting us into your home, for joining us this morning, for helping to create this space of worship. It's so good to be gathered together. It's different than what we are accustomed to, although different is beginning to shift and change. Here in this space, we know by saying the words together of liturgy, of reading together, of sharing the stories, of singing along together, that we can feel and lean into the Spirit. The Spirit that is already present everywhere we go. So thank you for gathering together, for naming it, for claiming it, for feeling it, for experiencing it, and for being here for one another. Today, we lift up and we talk about our mental health. It's been our practice over the past several years to take a Sunday in May, and perhaps we need more Sundays than just a Sunday in May, but today especially, we are mindful of mental health, and we'll be saying a little bit more about that throughout worship, but we hope that you find what you need here in this space and hear a message of hope and know that there are times when it's okay to not be okay. It's okay to celebrate and to feel all the joy. In that spirit, I know there are so many birthdays out there in the past few days. The Boons are celebrating an anniversary today. So we are thankful we get to celebrate and hope that you find a way to lift up those that you love and care for and celebrate this day. A few other things about the life of the church is you'd like to know more about what's going on. The church, even though we're not gathered together in a building, is alive and well and moving and breathing and active. So as you'd like to know more about what's happening and how we're connecting, we encourage you to sign up. We are still working on plans for the summer and some other creative ways that we will be church and be gathering together. But for the time being, we'll continue to share worship here online. So again, encourage you to sign up to find out more about how to stay connected and to all the things that are going on. There will be a community collaborative meeting after church this morning. So as we gather in our time for fellowship, there'll be a breakout session. So if you're interested in helping us to plan and think about some of the ways that we might continue to show up for one another and some creative gathering spaces, we encourage you to come into that space and join us after worship. We'll share that in the comments below. Again, thank you for being with us. Thank you for welcoming us into your home. And thank you for sharing in the comments. I encourage you to keep saying hi to each other and dropping in emojis and writing notes to each other. It's really fun to text in church. So we're glad that we can connect with each other and share together in this way. So thank you again. Let us join and center our hearts as we share together the words from the sacred stories this morning.
From Acts chapter 1. As a result, those who had gathered together asked Jesus, "Lord, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel now?" Jesus replied, "It isn't for you to know the times or seasons that the Father has set by his own authority. Rather, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, and in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." After Jesus said these things, as they were watching, he was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going away and as they were staring toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood next to them. They said, "Galileans, why are you standing here looking toward heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way that you saw him go into heaven."
Then they returned to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. And when they entered the city, they went to the upstairs room where they were staying. Peter, John, James, and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, Alphaeus' son, Simon the Zealot, and Judas, James' son. All were united in their devotion to prayer, along with some women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. These are the stories of new life. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, story keepers and friends. As we listen to these sacred stories, I'm reminded of why we retell and rethink these stories over and over again, because sometimes the Spirit sends new ways for us to look or understand. And that happened to me this week with the story keepers as I looked at this story in our story keepers Bible, and it was telling us about how between the time when Jesus went to live with God and the time that the Holy Spirit was given on the day we call Pentecost, which we'll celebrate next Sunday, that the people were gathered together and remembering Jesus and the things that he had promised them. And they were praying together and remembering all those wonderful times they had with Jesus, as well as the sad ones. And then Pentecost comes at the end of that. And I had always kind of thought that, okay, The Holy Spirit just comes boom on Pentecost, and that's when it happens. But in looking at this story and how the people were holding each other and praying together and giving each other strength, I started to look at Pentecost in a new way, because the Spirit was already with the disciples. It was with them and in them and amongst them. And the things they did to strengthen each other grew the Spirit, until at Pentecost, maybe instead of coming boom all at once, the Holy Spirit had finally grown in them so much and filled them up so much that it spilled over out of them instead of some suddenly coming into their life. So see, even old people can learn by retelling and rethinking the stories over and over again. As we finish the story this week, I ask you to share with me symbols, which we have been talking about, symbols of things that give you strength and grow your spirit. So now, story keepers, I ask you, what gives you strength?
Hey guys, me and Dexter here. Dexter makes me feel like Jesus is in the room, because Jesus was probably friendly, and so is Dexter. Dexter brings me strength when I'm very sad. He makes me feel joyful, and he brings light to me. So yeah, that's Dexter for you.
Hammering makes me feel strong. I hammered these boards together, and then I painted it, and then I painted this background, and then I hammered the cross to the background, and it all made me feel strong.
Oh, story keepers. You make me stronger and grow the Spirit in me. I can't wait till Wednesday, when we're going to talk some more about Pentecost and the symbols that we use to remind us of that special day when, again, maybe the Spirit didn't fall down suddenly from heaven, but was in us all the time and grew from the ways we gave each other strength and hope until it finally just spilled over. So, thank you, God, for Spirit and for the way it grows in us. Amen.
This morning, as we gather to pray, we invite you to light a candle, to name and claim that that Spirit is with us. Here, as we gather, we invite you to share your prayers and the comments. Remember that the comments here are public. So if you would only want to be named by first name, whatever you lift up into this space, you are also encouraged to send us your prayers privately if you would like us to hold them in that space. So again, we give thanks that we get to gather and to pray for one another. We know that each of us finds and claims the Spirit differently. So whether that's through colored pencils, whether that's getting to be outside, however, wherever you are gathered this morning, we invite you to find your breath. The prayer that I'll be sharing this morning was one that was written as part of our liturgy project. John Scroggins has written this prayer. We heard earlier a prayer from Stephanie Scott Huffman. So just want to lift up and give thanks to those of you who are writing and helping to craft and cultivate our liturgy that we share together each week. So thank you. Let us find the Spirit, however, wherever we do that this morning, and gather in a breath and naming and claiming God is with us. We gather as the children of God. a flock divided by unseen threats. We long for the comfort of our closeness, a warm hug, a handshake, a kiss on the cheek, under the watchful eye of our Good Shepherd. In this time of uncertainty, we reflect upon these challenges of the early churches, of the early church, who under the threat of death had the fortitude to gather in catacombs and offer prayers and songs of thanksgiving. Our collective voices raised in song may be distance, but in our solitude we find comfort in these words. Beautifully written prayers set to music that bring enlightenment just as surely as scripture. Today we choose to stand on the promises of God and gather in the garden of your promises. We gather the essence of strength and fortitude, of love and courage, compassion and ingenuity, and surround ourselves and our community with your brilliant healing light. Peace that passes all understanding, love that endureth all things, faith that can move mountains, and the promise of everlasting life. We nourish the garden of the promises with the sweat on our brow, the salt of our tears, and the joy and the knowledge that the Good Shepherd always watches over the flock. And for these many blessings, we give thanks.
Together as this community, we offer our prayers for Tyler's boss and mentor who passed away this week. We pray for his family and everyone close to him. We pray for Jacob's awesome dog, Cassius. We pray that we continue to lift our children and model the Jesus way for them. We pray for our pastors. We pray for MJ's daughter, who will have an MRI this week, and for all of her children, that they may feel God's love for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Over the past few years, as I mentioned, we have participated in a Mental Health Sunday in worship. Our goals have included cultivating a sacred space to talk openly and honestly about our mental health, reducing stigma about living with mental illness, and sharing good resources with one another. This month is Mental Health Awareness Month. So as it has been our practice to share relevant information about living with mental health, about anxiety and depression, that we know in this moment, already 1 in 5 people are living with mental illness. We notice people are talking about it. People are sharing with one another and reaching out for help and support. People are finding support and help to live with mental illness that requires medication and treatment. Thanks be to God. The conversation is changing. And while we know there is so much work yet to be done, we see the evidence of that things are changing. We also know right now our collective mental health needs some attention. Living in the midst of a pandemic, there are uncertainties that face us, and it is a collective trauma that we are experiencing right now. We know that when a large group experiences a collective trauma, that there's an emotional bond. There are a lot of things that happen out of this space. Dr. Molly Castillo, an expert in psychology who has worked on this with many folks who survived extreme trauma, she shares that collective trauma means, first of all, a shared sense of helplessness, disorientation, and loss among a group of people. But she continues to explain the threatening event gives rise to a shared identification. Despite the fact that the victimized individuals or those living in the midst of trauma have different personalities and family backgrounds, different coping mechanisms and capacities for resilience emerge. The effects of trauma are evident on our mental health. She continues, "This is a public health catastrophe, a failure of democracy and ideals. There are so many deaths of the elderly, the infirm, local healthcare workers, first responders. Every day, we are living through a shared trauma among us." Over the past few months, we've been talking about and holding the liturgy of the everyday, of the things of our ordinary lives, just the everydayness of what we do, being very present to the acts of making our beds, of discovering and rediscovering God in all the ways, in our walks, in our living, in our emails, in doing the dishes, in our work, and yes, on Zoom calls. God is present there. In the everyday, we are called to see God is there and discover ways to tend to and care for our mental health as we live in the everydayness of living in the midst of trauma. It's part of our narrative and something we need to pay attention to. The scriptures can offer us some insight and some ideas about tending to and giving our mental health attention. It's evident from the story we heard this morning in Acts. The disciples experienced a collective trauma. We greet the disciples in this story. It's the final Sunday of the Eastertide season. Even though we often think of Easter as a one-time moment, it's a story that goes on, and it's a season that we get to celebrate as we prepare to tell again the story of the church. We greet the disciples in a moment where they say a final goodbye of sorts to Jesus. Eastertide is a season of learning to live in the midst of death, of knowing that it's part of the story, and discovering different narratives in this space. When the disciples realize that Jesus is gone, or with them differently, they gather to pray. They find a unified and a shared space to come together. In their grief, in their fear, they come together, and they find ways to share their pain, their hope, their sorrow, and their belief that if they come together, they can write a new narrative together. Something different will emerge. Jesus's death will mean something so much more. They can proclaim that there is new life. There is life from death. They can share a spirit of hope, of healing, and of possibility if they pray together and find center together. That's the best of what people who follow the way of Jesus can do. In the face of fear and the unknown, in the face of death, they find a way, however, whatever that looks like, to be gathered together for one another, to listen to one another, to show up for one another, and to support each other. After the first week of moving worship online, I thought, it's cool, it will be just fine. We'll be back together in no time, it'll be a few weeks, no big deal, we got this. This is no big deal. The church is so much more than a building, and this is only gonna last a season. A little over a week ago, I had the realization that worship was going to look probably more like this and look different for longer than what I had really wrapped my head around. I was reading reports and listening to infectious disease doctors. I was talking to colleagues, trying to find the best information, data-driven information that would help to inform us about what was going on. The reports were saying, singing is one of the best ways to share and contract the coronavirus. Singing, one of my very favorite things, something I love to do with you all. Gathering with large numbers of people, especially without masks, in poorly ventilated spaces where people hug and shake hands, where people pass trays and share communion and like to drink coffee. Ooh, I miss drinking coffee with you. That can contribute to the spread of COVID-19. And it became clear, even though it was not what we had originally thought or hoped or wanted, worship needed to stay online, again, for longer than what I had hoped or imagined. But it didn't mean that worship didn't still happen. It didn't mean that the church stopped. We could still come together and be church. That's what we do. We don't need a building to do that. Living with an abundance of uncertainty, of questions, of unknowns, it can cause our brains to kind of freak out. I begin to describe these moments of some of what I've been experiencing. I don't know if this will resonate with you, but it feels like waves, and often like tidal waves. There's those waves of realization, the wave of joy, a wave of new information, the wave of trying to even begin to process the number of deaths, the wave of finding the best practices to stay safe online, and all of these waves, they can take a toll on our mental health. Last week, I started a new book. Not a new book, but new to me. This book's been around for 20, 25 years. It's called When Things Fall Apart. Pema Chodron, the American Tibetan Buddhist nun and teacher, weaves together her own awakening in the midst of her personal crisis and these ancient teachings that she comes from a Buddhist tradition, which I think can be very applicable. This book didn't provide any kind of answers, but it did help to give a grounding, not to explain or make sense of anything, but just an invitation to walk deeper into practices of calm, of prayer, of meditation, of questions, of the dailiness of living into this space. The first chapter talks about intimacy with fear. Chogyan writes, "Embarking on the spiritual journey is like getting into a very small boat and setting out onto the ocean to search for unknown lands. With wholehearted practice comes inspiration, but sooner or later, we will also encounter fear. For all we know, when we get to the horizon, we're going to drop off the edge of the world. Like all explorers, we are drawn to discover what's out there waiting without knowing yet if we have the courage to face us. Impermanence becomes vivid in present moments. So does compassion and wonder and courage, and so does fear. In fact, anyone who stands on the edge of unknown, fully present, without reference points, experiences groundlessness. That's when our understanding goes deeper. When we find that the present moment is a pretty vulnerable place, and this can be completely unnerving and completely tender at the exact same time. Things fall apart. It's kind of like a testing and kind of a healing. We think that the point is to pass the test or to overcome the problem, but the truth is things don't really get solved. They come together and they fall apart." She continues to write, "They come together again and they fall apart again. It's just like that. The healing comes from letting there be room for all of this to happen. Room for grief, for relief, for misery, and for joy." So friends, how do we make room? How do we make room when the messages are competing and conflicting, when there's still so much unknown? The disciples came together and they prayed. They put into practice the things that offered them center, the things that reminded them God was with them. Wherever they were, we gathered together on Zoom, online, through emails, through text messages, and we pray for one another. We listen to each other. We show up for one another to offer care to each other. We lean into love. When they listen to their call to be church in radically challenging circumstances, the disciples found a way. And they tended to one another as they did it. They knew and they remind us, Jesus' love is not gone. It has not gone up somewhere far away. It is still right here with us. God's love goes with us no matter where we are. May we lean into it and lean into one another as we feel its presence with us. May it be so. Amen.
In my ocean depths explore, hey, rich and full.
I go about my work each day with my clients, I usually begin the session by checking in with them about how their week has gone. And I'm also checking in with me. You know, how has my week gone? What's happening with my mental health? And people are depending on me to be there for them and to have sometimes to have answers, or they just need to talk. And I have those needs also. I have the need to be heard and to find somebody sometimes that does have an answer, or to have a question that helps me find the answer in me. And so as I think about this time of when we're so many are struggling with emotionally and psychologically with the difficulty that we're dealing with, I also think about how am I dealing with it? And I would urge others, I'm not the only one in our congregation or whoever might be listening, that feels they're in a position of others depending on them. And so I would urge you to reach out, to not think about that you have to be the strong one. We refer to it in my profession sometimes as the halo effect, you know, like we're not supposed to have to deal with anything. We should have all the answers, or we should be the symbol of good mental health. But we're human and we have issues that we have to deal with too. And so I encourage anyone of any position to reach out and to remember these words. Sometimes we depend on the strength of our neighbors, and sometimes our neighbors depend on ours. We take turns shouldering together the shared burdens of life. Through one another, God upholds us. In gratitude for this and all gifts of the community, let us bring together our resources in spirit and offering.
We shall overcome. was beautiful. Thank you to the Chancel Quartet for that reminder. We all need someone to lean on. Will you all join me in our prayer of thanksgiving? God, our comfort and our strength, bless our offerings and renew our spirits. As you call the faithful to courage in these days, we hope to rise to the occasion. Where you ask us to endure, bring us companionship in the struggle. Where you ask us to share what we have, may our hearts overflow with generosity. Where you ask us to open ourselves to radical change, make us brave and wild with imagination. For your kingdom, enable us to live the love we desire. Amen.
For everyone born, a place at the table. The bread and the cup symbolizes human lives interconnected with other human lives and the power of giving and receiving. May the passion for life as seen in Jesus and in the lives and the struggles of many other committed and faithful people then and now enable us to dare and to dream and to risk. Together, may we reimagine the world. Together, may we work to make all things new. Together, may we celebrate the possibilities and hope we have and are called to share. For everyone born, a place at the table. We break this bread. For our broken humanity, for the powerful and powerless, trapped by exploitation and oppression, may there be healing where there is pain and woundedness. We break this bread for the unhealed hurts and wounds that lie within all of us. May we be healed. This is the cup and the peace of new life for all, a sign of love for the community of hope, a reminder of the call to live fully, to love with all that we are, and to be all that we can be together.
For us. As we partake of the bread of life and the cup of hope that connect us to Christ and each other, we celebrate our memories of those who made life better for us. During this uncertain time, we find comfort in these elements, which fortify us and remind us that we are never alone. Christ is everywhere. Christ is with those who have been furloughed and those who have lost loved ones to the pandemic. Christ is with the lonely, the hungry, the homeless, and those who live with mental illness struggles. May we take the loving spirit of Christ present in our shared tables into our community in the week ahead, whether it is through Zoom, Facebook, text, or phone call. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we share peace today, we invite you to comment on this thread or to join us in Zoom. Give a high five, a hello, a selfie, something so we can see and greet one another.
respects each other's ways, where love is lived and all is done with justice and with praise. Oh, for a world where goods are shared and misery relieved, where truth is spoken and children spared, equality achieved. We welcome struggle with each choice that opens us to unity and gives a vision voice. The poor and rich, the weak and strong, the foolish ones are wise. Tell all who mourn, outcasts we long, who perishes will rise. Oh, for a
A quick reminder that we will be gathering for fellowship time and our community collaborative. I was a birthday bombed, so a huge thanks, and got the joy of having a cupcake for communion. I do love that really communion is whatever, wherever. This morning, Amy was baking bread. She's actually been wearing her apron. I don't know if you noticed that, but that's pretty spectacular and wonderful. There was beautiful music that was actually played at the church this morning. So again, thank you for coming and being with us. Thank you for sharing your time and letting us be in your home this morning, and sharing prayers and showing up for one another. As we go from this space, we want you to remember, may the grace that says you are not alone, may it encourage you. May the mercy that says you are enough comfort you. May the love that says you are loved embrace you this day and every day. May it be so. Amen.